Now, where do you come from and where are you going?
I'm trying to find my way home.
Your way! Always here are my ways!
So, we have possibly found a new school of Disney villainy, a new level of evil.
Evil!
Will you please stop saying that?
Evil!
Yes, yes, yes. And to understand this school, we first have to look back at its predecessors. So first we had the school of the Evil Queen, which was very classic evil. Pretty much, so almost like a force of nature kind of evil, sort of raw and primal. Then we come to the school of Lady Tremaine, the manipulator, someone who excels at control over one person or the ability to move a group of people. Pretty much selling the con in a lot of ways. Then we come to the school of Maleficent, the showman. The evil is not just a thing you do, it's what you are. You get up every day and you make an evil kind of sexy, alright? And so with those three, I had to think, is there another one? So, if you had to really sum up this school, I want you to think of someone who is in a position over you and that's really the only thing that's stopping you from throwing hands with them, because they're kind of terrible. They just are. And if, like, you know, if you didn't need this job, if they didn't have these guards, if, you know, they didn't have all these sort of extra things going for them, you'd throw hands. You would throw hands. And why? Because they just don't get it. They don't quite understand what it means to be a leader, to be in this sort of position. There's a difference between this and the other schools. The other schools have this sort of dignity about them, sort of class style about them. And they take what they do seriously. They may enjoy some of it, but they have clear goals in mind. And you get that maybe there's something interesting about them. But overall, what you see with these characters here is they're compensating for something. There's something wrong with their lives. They really have to put emphasis on these symbols, on the idea that they're the ones in charge, and no one can forget it. Alright? And they present themselves in what they think is the person in charge. This is usually designed of people in authority, of royalty figures. This is why the Queen of Hearts. Sort of look at, say, Prince John in Robin Hood. You know, he's this character, he dresses with this very long regal robe, you know, he's got this crown, and he pretty much spends all his time basking in himself, loving every minute of it, and he just wants to remind you that he's the king, like he's got this power. I think he does it a bit better.
This crown gives me a feeling of power. Forgive me a cruel chuckle.
And he doesn't like it when people don't acknowledge that. Same thing with the Queen of Hearts. The Queen of Hearts goes the extra mile. Remember, all ways are her ways. And you really just figure, if she didn't have this army, someone would have stopped her. Because even her army is afraid of her. Over the fact that they planted the wrong roses. Which is still a great song, by the way.
The queen, she likes some bread. If she saw white instead,
she'd raise a fuss,
and each of us would quickly lose his head.
Goodness!
Great, great. She has a sort of hodgepodge trial because she has to have the trial. Or rather, she's convinced to have a trial. If she had it her way, everyone would lose their head. Really quick, in this sort of kangaroo court. And everyone sort of goes out of the way to appease her. There's a lot of sound and fury signifying these characters. Go a step further to characters who may not fit this exact mold, but have certain elements to them. Prince John and the Queen of Hearts are sort of textbook examples of these, but there's also a certain lack of general intelligence. So you could argue that for, say, Queen Grimhild, that, you know, her wanting to kill Snow White is kind of stupid. Stupid politically, but if you were to take a step back and take a look at how she's viewing it, you know, the idea that, you know, her role as queen, dowager queen even, her political power is fading, you know, And Snow White is a reminder of how she's the old guard who will soon pass along. Snow White will eventually, you know, take over for her. So there's that. Someone who puts emphasis on their looks is now threatened by this child. It's stupid, but you can see a bit of logic to it. But then you have characters like, say, Captain Hook. Now, Captain Hook has some justification. If a 10-year-old cut off my hand and fed it to a crocodile, I would feel some kind of way. But he could also just leave. He really could. His crew doesn't look down on him for getting one-up by a 10-year-old. They don't. They're troopers for that. They are. And they're what you call the real ones. They really are. They really are. Because I'd have been like, no, I'm out. No. But they'll follow him to the end. To the end. That's great loyalty. Then you have characters like, say, Edgar from the Aristocats, who is the dumbest villain ever. Really is. So what is Edgar's problem? Edgar is upset that the cats, you know, Duchess, Tullio, Berlioz, Marie, will inherit Madame's fortune.
Adelaide, you mean to say you're leaving a vast fortune to Edgar? Everything you possess? Stocks, bonds, this mansion, your country chateau, our treasures, jewels, and...
No, George, to my cats.
To your cats?
Yes, George.
And, yeah, okay, I'd feel some way about that too. But, essentially, all Edgar has to do is take care of the cats, and more than likely, he would be spending the money for them. So, you know, hey, they need a fancy car. Why? So, they just need me to drive them around. Yeah, I need better clothes because, well, I need to look good while, you know, providing for these cats, you know? He's going to live in the mansion still. He can actually move to a better room in the mansion. You know, that's it. He wins, but no. He decides, I've got to kill these cats. And then he wants to brag about it. You know, the dumbest bragging ever. And then he's like, oh, wait, I left stuff here that really couldn't be traced back to me. But I gotta go get it. And then he starts fighting these cats. And then he ends up getting sent to Timbuktu. He can never show his face again. Now, there were rumors of Aristocats too. Thankfully, that got squashed. Because unless Edgar comes back with a gun, I'm not going to take him seriously. And that's sort of a thing too. There's a certain amount of buffoonery to these characters. They're villains that you're not afraid of, but you just sort of laugh at them. Like they're threats. Like, you know, they present some form of threat. But the threat isn't in them, it's what they bring to the table. And granted, there is sometimes some moment of genius to them. Captain Hook, Prince John, both have this sort of, every now and then, great ideas. Honestly, trying to fire a cannon at a kid who can fly is stupid. Alright, it's never going to hit him. It's never going to hit him. But the idea of manipulating Tinkerbell and allowing and being able to drop a bomb in his house, that was great. The only reason that really failed was because, well, Tinkerbell escaped. Prince John, people forget this, but no one told Prince John that the stork was Robin Hood. Now, honestly, in all of Nottingham, it was very unlikely there was any other archer more skilled than the sheriff and Robin Hood. It's just how the story presents itself. So, yeah, that was obviously it, but no one else knew. But Prince John figured it out pretty quick. And, you know, he got it. And he sentenced Robin to...
I sentence you to sudden, instant, and even immediate death.
Now that's petty. That means he wanted him dead last week. That's it. But again, what happens? When the authorities take it from, when he's in a position where he has to be held accountable, where he has to deal with it, he cowers. Same thing with the Queen of Hearts. There's a certain jokery to them. That when they're on the back foot, they start begging. They start crying. They can't back anything up. And Madame Mim even falls into this category because of something else here. These characters all have certain people living rent-free in their heads. Now, for Prince John and Captain Hook, it kind of makes sense. You know, Prince John got fleeced by Robin Hood. he got. And Captain Hook, again, hand cut off by a 10-year-old, fed to a crocodile. You know, you gotta feel a certain way. But you're also just really focusing too much on there are better things you could be doing. Prince John sees himself as someone who is constantly in the shadow of his brother, King Richard.
Mother. Mother always did like Richard best.
A sky!
Traitor to the crown. That crown belongs to King Richard.
Long live King Richard!
Long live King Richard!
Enough!
And the movie does a great job when we see King Richard, as well as the original ending to Disney's Robin Hood. Does a great job of that. But even more so, look at Madam Mim. Madam Mim is, let's say at best, equally as powerful as Merlin. Alright? Magic goes in a different direction. She's more than likely a tier below. But she's still the most powerful, she's still one of the two most powerful beings in this universe. Alright? Finding out that Merlin's even mentioned, like, Merlin? I'm better than Merlin. And that leads to a fight, which Merlin doesn't care about. Like, Merlin really doesn't care about Madam Mim. And that might be what upsets her the most. That might be it. Like, he doesn't consider me. It's not that he doesn't consider her lesser. He just has other things to do. Merlin views his magic as something that is used to benefit mankind, to benefit people. He puts it all on education, that because I have power, I have an obligation to use it to better society. Mim just says, I have magic, and I kind of get off on hurting people. That's kind of it. Like, if I find out someone's sick, I hope it's infectious. I hope it's contagious. I hope it's deadly. You know? So yeah, she's terrible. But what happens when, once again, put on that back foot? She starts begging. And she's also still equally smart. A lot of these characters are smart when there's something they want, but they tend to not think. I said Edgar was stupid, but Prince John is also equally stupid. Because Prince John had the bright idea to think of executing a man in the church.
Friar Tuck will be led to the gallows in the village square, don't you see?
Sire, hang Friar Tuck, a man of the church.
When our elusive hero tries to rescue the corpulent cleric, my men will be ready.
Let's point out the political backlash that would be. The Queen of Hearts is essentially, she incites a rebellion. She risks inciting a rebellion every time she opens her mouth. How long before they say, you know what? No more. No more. Democracy is the way. When I think of the best way to define these characters, two people come in mind. There's this scene here with Lord Farquaad.
Marriage is binding, and that makes me king! See? See?
That is categorically this school. This level of buffoonery. And of course, this scene here from Game of Thrones.
I am the king! I will punish you.
Any man who must say, I am the king, is no true king.
And that's the key to this. There's a lot of false bravado here. There's a lot of, I'm in charge. This is me, you know. I'm the big man. And it turns out, they're not. They're just loud and pathetic. Well, say what you want about the other great Disney villains. You know, Queen Grimhild, Shere Khan, Lady Tremaine, Gaston, Frollo, Gothel, you know, of course, Maleficent, Ursula, Jafar, Hades. These characters may have had their hang-ups, but they were at least confident enough in their own power where they knew to mostly hold their, where they knew not to concern themselves with the opinions of sheep. Most of the time. Captain Hook can't deal with it. Granted, if a 10-year-old cut off my hand and fed to a crocodile, I'd be a bit salty too. Madam Mim can't handle it when anyone just says, I prefer how Merlin uses his magic. She takes that as a great offense. Like, well, I've got to kill this kid. That's it. There's a level of pathetic that comes here. Remember, we're talking about a company that has put out villains that says, this 14-year-old girl is prettier than me. I gots to kill her. That's, I don't know what more to tell you. She's got to die. But there's a level of competency to that. Alright, which is weird to say. Because I get the feeling that no matter how much you dislike villains like Tremaine or Grimhild or Maleficent, you at least get the feeling that these are functioning members of society. Like, someone has told them no before. They've had to make some horrible sacrifices, and they at least know how to do the job they think they're good at. You know? With this school here, the school of the bully, the child, they're not really good at anything. They just have a bunch of people who are, like, dedicated to them, who are mostly using them for any other advantage. We saw this with Prince John. The sheriff just wants to be able to exert whatever authority he wants. He wants that power and influence that comes with, you know, dishing out the king's justice. Captain Hook's crew. Hey, look, we're on a ship. We're traveling. We don't gotta work. We're in Neverland where we never age. It's great. You know, the Queen of Hearts, you know, her people, they're just along for the ride for the most part. She's really only in charge because she's literally the Queen of Hearts. That's kind of it. She's so petty that for this, they all know they're going to be at. At the same time, this mid-boss energy is, I think, personified in Toatuma, in Moana. Toatuma, I think, if it had been reworked, he would have been a better antagonist. He would have been the final boss. But Moana goes in a different route, which I think works for Moana. I don't think it should be the direction we're going in the future for Disney villains. But this actually is where Disney villains, I think, are going. With how the protagonist is now pretty much their own character on their own journey. It's more about them than it is the world itself. And that'll have its own ups and downs later. But Toatuma is an interesting bully character because he does derive his worth from the image of how he looks. You know, he parallels that to Maui, who has this idea of what he should be, and one of the big things about him is the hook, you know, and being able to transform into whatever. Toatuma embraces that too. You know, he's got to have his outer appearance, he's got to look a certain way, and he's made it work for him. But he now sees that he has greater value than anyone else because of it. Like, it's kind of a joke, if you think about it. But for these characters, the joke is more obvious. In recent years, I think this is what's become the default Disney villain. Not having seen Raya the Last Dragon, look at Moana. Toatuma is a joke of a character, all right? He's found a great way to provide for himself, you know, by being, it has allowed him to survive, you know, he's got a steady stream of food, but he's now gone the extra mile. He derives his worth from it. So no matter how intimidating he is, he puts a lot of it on just that appearance. You know, he was essentially afraid of Maui. And before it turns out the hook, he, you know, couldn't use his hook properly. Then he's back on top like, yeah, I got you. I got you. And there's a certain sadness to that. Where with the other characters, you realize something bad may have happened to them. There's a big theory about Lady Tremaine, and there's more story into that. Same thing with other characters. This is an issue I think I have lately with explaining why villains are the way they are. Because they all try to come off as sympathetic. Hence this Cruella de Vil prequel origin story? What origin can you tell me to explain why she wants to murder puppies for a coat? There isn't. But this school, I think, is more showing how pathetic evil can be somewhere. This sort of me, me, me mentality. Whereas everyone else sort of tries to be like this great big evil, like, I like the power. And even then, those characters, every other school has villains that are competent, that you could be put on the back foot, that you can't quite figure them out. They haven't earned confidence. Shere Khan doesn't derive confidence from just the fact that people fear him. You know, people fear him because he's Shere Khan. He carries himself with that level of confidence. These other characters carry themselves sort of draping themselves in the power. Power that they haven't earned. Power they've usually inherited. Or they're motivated by the sense of hubris that they feel they deserve something. And they're the smarter people. They're sort of like, this is the one thing they have in common with Disney Renaissance era villains. like characters like Jafar. Jafar also sort of has certain connections to this school. Because remember, when Jafar has the lamp, you know, what is the first thing he does? He wishes to be Sultan. If you think about it, that's an ego trip. I want to be in charge. And when they didn't listen to him, when Jasmine refused to bow, the only one who refused to, he's like, fine, I'll become the world's most powerful sorcerer, which should have been his first wish. Should have been his first wish. And then he still got power. Jasmine still doesn't want him. It upsets him that Jasmine does not reciprocate any form of advance. When he doesn't even really want her, he calls her a shrew earlier on. He's sort of against the idea of marrying her, like, no, no. But now that he has the power and she says no, like, how dare she? How dare she? And when Aladdin points out, the genie still has more power than you. No one has more power than me, and I'll prove it. I'll become the genie, and then he loses. The school of the child, of the buffoon, takes that moment from Aladdin and makes it their entire character. That's really it. So who are the standouts of this? Well, of course, we have Captain Hook. Captain Hook's kind of low tier. Edgar might be the king of this from the Aristocats because, again, incredibly, incredibly stupid. Toa is more fascinating than he is a flat-out buffoon. Madame Mim is just enjoyable. She's sort of like a Renaissance-era villain. You know, she's got the song, she's got the presentation, but she's a bit too... She tries to be sort of a parody of evil in the same way that Queen Grimhild is. Queen Grimhild is very stereotypically evil. But I think by default, after the Queen of Hearts, it goes to Prince John. Prince John, who, you know, there's a only Cruella de Vil has a hate song about her. And Prince John. Prince John and Cruella de Vil have this one thing in common. The difference is Cruella de Vil just kind of, you know, this is before she decides to kill, you know, she wants to kill a bunch of puppies. An entire village makes a song mocking Prince John. A song that is so great that even his henchmen are singing it. That is hilarious. So anyway, with this in mind, this concludes this School of Disney Villainy, The Child, The Buffoon. Name still pending. It'll be in the thumbnail. I promise you. It'll be in the actual title. So what did you guys think of it? Is it more of a reach of a school? I can kind of see that. What did you think about it? Did you love it? Did you hate it? Who do you think sums up the epitome of Disney-level buffoonery? Who then, if they didn't have all this extra aesthetics... You know, the guards, sometimes the magic, you would just throw hands with them. There's probably other villains you just throw hands with anyway. So anyway, we'll bring this video to a close here. If you're new to the Bucket Think Tank, feel free to like, comment, share, subscribe. Check out some other videos, and I will catch you all later. This is the Bucket Think Tank signing off. Thanks for watching, and as always, may your fandom serve you well.